Let us take an example where you switch on the computer but it doesn't start. Now you start speculating the various options. You start imagining the various reasons because of which the computer is not getting started. Let us see a few examples of what your imagination could be. The plug is not connected to the wall outlet. In that case, you would check the plug connection, whether it is properly inserted, whether there is no gap and things like that. If that is working, suppose, then the next speculation could be the computer is having a booting problem. So in order to check this speculation, your action would be you would check the booting system. Maybe you would connect the computer somewhere else and then check whether the computer is having problem or there are any other problems. Imagine that there is no problem with the booting system. Computer starts when you connect to the other point. Then the next speculation could be the fuse is burnt in the house. So one goes and checks the fuse. It is working. Then what could be the reason why the computer is not starting? So the next speculation could be there is a power failure. So in order to check whether there is a power failure, one checks the other instruments in the house whether they are working properly. One even can check the neighbor's house whether they have the electric supply. So in this case we have seen that there is a problem that the computer is not starting even after switching on. Then you come up with some speculations and depending on one speculation there is a action, testing of that speculation. In case of research, such speculations are termed as hypotheses. So hypothesis is a technical term. This term is used in the research for the speculation by the researcher. In the research, we say that it is a problem at hand. We study some problem. So this hypothesis is the tentative solution of that problem. It is also the researcher's hunch about the tentative solution. Now, what is the basis of this tentative solution or the researcher's hunch? It could be the previous theory, it could be the earlier researches, could be also the researcher's own experiences. So on the basis of all these, the researcher writes down the hypothesis or writes down the tentative solution to the problem. Hypothesis help to narrow down the research further. We have seen already that from the research titles, when we come to the objectives, the research work actually gets narrowed down and more specificity is added. From objectives, when we come to the hypothesis, the work gets further narrowed down and actually exactly what is to be observed gets clear to the researcher. The major role that the hypothesis perform is the development of the theory. The hypothesis help in bringing together the earlier information about the tentativeness of how the variables involved may be related with each other. The hypothesis provides the relational statement that could be directly tested in the research and thus gives the more specific form to the research. It also helps in giving the direction to the research depending on what is to be tested in the hypothesis. The research takes that direction. It also gives the framework in which the research needs to be reported at the end and also to the findings. Now, where do these hypotheses actually originate? Yes, they have the previous background of earlier experiences, earlier researches and so on. But when we come to the actually operationalizing the hypothesis statement, they are generated from the objectives. So just like for any child, it takes birth from a mother. Similarly, the objectives play the role of a mother for the hypothesis child. So for every hypothesis, there has to be objective or a mother objective for every hypothesis. But it is not necessary that every objective will give rise to the hypothesis. It depends on the content of the objective, whether it needs hypothesis for testing or otherwise. We will see a few examples to understand how the objectives and the hypothesis are related with each other. We'll read a research title, A Comparative Study of Behavioristic and Constructivistic Approaches to Technoandragogy. One of its objectives is to study the effectiveness of constructivistic technoandragogical approach in terms of metacognition. Now let us see how the hypothesis is written. The constructivistic technoandragogical treatment has no effect in terms of metacognition. So in this case, the hunch or the maybe tentative solution to the problem is written in the form that there is significant relationship between the two. Okay, we will see the second pair of objective and the hypothesis. The objective reads as, to compare reaction of technoandragogical approaches in the context of levels of learning style. Here the hypothesis is written as, there is no significant difference between the reactions to technoandragogical approaches in the context of levels of learning style. So in this case, the hypothesis says that the levels of learning style do make the difference in the reaction to the treatment. So in this case, we have seen that the two hypotheses, one was talking about there wouldn't be any difference, whereas the other one was talking about there would be definitely some difference which will be significant. So in this way, the objective had its pairing with the hypothesis in that research. How do we write the hypothesis? So here are a few guidelines for writing the hypothesis. One needs to take a review of the earlier researches that would give the better understanding of what has been done earlier in this area, and then it gives a better foundation for the researcher to write the hypothesis. The second guideline is the define the operational definitions to the maximum possible details. We have already discussed this part when we discussed the operational definitions, and we have also said why and how important it is to detail out the operational definition of a term. So here it is one more reason why the operational definition should be given with maximum details. When they are listed out with all the possible aspects and how it will be measured, because we talk of measurement and observation in when we talk of operational definitions. So how they will be measured, once that is fixed, it gives a direct seeding for the hypothesis writing. Writing down all the variables type wise. This once again we had discussed when we talked about the variables and how important it is to write the as many variables as possible which are affecting or which are playing the role in the situation under study. When we list down all the variables in the study, the exercise helps in writing the hypothesis for that particular study. If a study is comparing groups, then the groups needs to be explicitly written. If the comparison is between, say, high level of creativity and low level of creativity, then that should be specified. If the comparison is between the genders, then maybe the men and women, that those two categories could be specified. Similarly, if there are variables under study, then the tentative relationship between the variables also needs to be specified before writing the hypothesis. One also needs to identify the participants and the site under study. For example, which level of students are under consideration? So it may be, say, post-graduation level students, or maybe standard 7 students, standard 10 students, and so on. Because where exactly the research is being conducted is made clear through when we write about site, which school or which level and so on, which country maybe. This is especially useful when the socio-cultural aspects, they have their impact. And the last stage is to make the predictions about the tentative result. For example, it could be difference or no difference. If it is, you know, higher or lower, then one would speak in terms of higher performance, lower performance, and so on. If it is a correlation between the two variables, then one would speak in terms of the two are correlated with each other, highly correlated, or there is no correlation between the variables. Before writing the hypothesis, the researcher also should ask some of these questions to oneself. Which are the variables under study? This will include the dependent, independent, control, and intervening variables. They need to be listed down in as detail as possible, as we have already discussed. The next question is, what is exactly being studied? Whether it is a comparison or whether it is a relationship between the variables. The hypothesis would always talk about either the comparison or the relationship, and that is the reason why the questions should be addressed to whether it is a comparison or whether it is a relationship. We will understand this further when we see exact construction of the statements in short time. The next question to be asked is, how will be the dependent variable measured? Similarly, how will be the independent variable measured? Since we talk about the actual scores and the measurements, these two questions about how the variable will be measured are crucial. We have said that there are two possibilities in case of a hypothesis. One is either comparison, or another could be a relationship. Similarly, there could be another two possibilities about the hypothesis. That suppose we talk of the comparison, then when we compare the two attributes, there is no difference between the two attributes. Whatever difference or marginal difference that is seen, it could be due to incidence. So it could be an incidental difference and not a real difference. So in order to talk about this real difference, the terminology that is used in hypothesis is significant difference. Or if it is a relationship, it is termed as significant relationship. So when the researcher wants to say that there is a significant relationship, or there is a definitely and a real difference between the two scores, then in that case, the researcher uses something called as the research hypothesis or the directional hypothesis. It is also called as the alternative hypothesis. The case where the researcher would say that there is no significant difference between the two scores, or there is no significant relationship between the two variables, in such cases, that hypothesis would be termed as the null hypothesis. We will see the difference between the two types of the hypothesis, that is the null hypothesis and the directional hypothesis. The purpose of having the null hypothesis, where the attributes are studied in terms of there is no difference, so the researcher wants to take the neutral stand about the relationship or about the comparisons. The directional hypothesis comes into picture when the null hypothesis is rejected. The rejection of null hypothesis means there is significant difference between the two, and if there is a difference, then one has to be at the higher level and another has to be at the lower level. So the research hypothesis talks about which one is at the higher level and which one is at the lower level. So thus the purpose of the two hypotheses definitely differs. How do the construction of the sentence differs in case of the two? When it is a null hypothesis and when it is a comparison of the two groups, then it would read something like, there is no significant difference between boys and girls in terms of intellectual abilities. If the same statement is to be written in the form of directional hypothesis, then it may be written something like, girls are at the higher level when it comes to intellectual level as compared to boys, or girls are at a higher level than the boys when it comes to intellectual level. If there is a relationship between the variables, the null hypothesis sentence would be, there is no significant relationship between variable x and variable y. If the same hypothesis is to be written in the directional form, it would be there is significant relationship between the variable x and variable y. So thus the forms of the null hypothesis and the directional hypothesis, they change. Both of them are tested using the statistical techniques, that is the commonality between the both the types of hypothesis. We have a few more examples of the hypothesis written. First, we will see a few examples of the null hypothesis. These examples are purposely taken to underline the role of the dependent and independent variable in the statement of the hypothesis. So we will see the first example. There is no significant difference between, say, pre-test and post-test in terms of achievement in maths. So here in this case, the scores of the pre-test and post-test would be considered for viewing or for judging the performance in the maths exam or the achievement in the maths exam. We'll see the second example. There is no significant relationship between use of social networking sites and achievement of students. Now in this case, we can see that there are two variables. The hypothesis talks about the two variables. The first one is the independent variable, that is the use of social networking sites. And the next one is the dependent variable, that is the achievement of students. So here is an example where we could see that how the two variables play the role in the hypothesis, how they are placed in the statement of hypothesis. We shall see the same example by writing it in the directional hypothesis way. There is positive relationship between the use of social networking sites and academic achievement of students. Now here once again the hypothesis talks about the relationship between the independent and dependent variable, but here it is the directional hypothesis since it talks that there is a positive relationship between the two variables. We will see one more example. Workshop on Prezi will make significant difference in performance of students. Now in this case, once again it is a relationship between the two variables. The one is the independent variable, that is the workshop on Prezi is the independent variable, and the performance of the students is the dependent variable. So the hypothesis talks about the relationship between the two variables. In order to understand what exactly happens to this hypothesis at the end of the study, just look at this table. Let us take first the example of the null hypothesis, that means the hypothesis of no significant difference. In that, there are two possibilities. The first possibility is the null hypothesis gets rejected. So what is the meaning of null hypothesis getting rejected? It means that there is a real difference, there is a significant difference between the x and y in terms of the, say, achievement of languages. The other possibility would be that the null hypothesis does not get rejected. Now here is an important point, that does not get rejected, please do not equate it to getting accepted. So we use the terminology, the null hypothesis gets retained. Now why do we write this word retain and why don't we write the word accepted? Now in order to say it is accepted, there would be many similar researches need to be conducted. They may be varying, say, in sample size, or maybe in different socio-cultural conditions and so on. Only after many such researches are conducted and all of them come up with the consistent result, only then one will be able to say that the null hypothesis is accepted. So it is a result of only the meta-analysis of the various researches. Otherwise, we do not use the word null hypothesis getting accepted. We have to use the word null hypothesis is retained. Let us see what happens in case of the directional hypothesis. Once again, Here also there are two possibilities. The first possibility is the directional hypothesis getting rejected. So directional hypothesis getting rejected, it means that there is no significant difference between the two entities under study. Here once again there are two possibilities. The first one is the rejection of the directional hypothesis. Now when the directional hypothesis says that X is better than Y, and when one is rejecting it, the meaning would be whatever difference between X and Y is found in the numerical terms, it is only because of the coincidence, and that is not a real difference between the two groups. The other possibility for the directional hypothesis will be the acceptance. Now here the word acceptance will be used in case of the directional hypothesis. And if the directional hypothesis is accepted, the original scent is that X is better than Y would be continued to be accepted as a result of that particular research. So this is how the null and directional hypotheses are treated at the level of statistics, at the end of statistics rather. You would be understanding these concepts in a better manner when we will discuss about the statistics. Now, there are some commonly made mistakes while writing the hypothesis. So, let us see them one by one. We saw that there is always a mother objective for every hypothesis. There cannot be a hypothesis without the mother objectives. But the researchers, sometimes they do write the hypothesis where there is no objective for it. So it is associated with, there is nothing at the ground and still the hypothesis takes birth, which is not possible. So that is one of the major mistakes that the researchers make. We have seen that the language of the hypothesis demands a certain way of construction of a sentence. And whether it is a comparison or whether it is a relationship, the language of the hypothesis needs to be in the specific way. It cannot be deviated from that. So at times the researchers do not stick to this fixed frame of the sentences and use some other forms which are not acceptable in case of hypothesis. Hypotheses are tentative solutions to the problem at hand. But they are definitely not the sermonized statements or a statements with the moral and emotional words. So sometimes the researchers use such kind of words in the hypothesis that should be completely avoided. The other kind of mistake that the researcher makes is they make a confusion between the hypothesis and assumptions. Sometimes they write assumptions in the name of hypothesis. And we should be better understanding this particular mistake made by the researchers when we talk about the assumptions in detail. We have thus seen that in the hypothesis play a major role in making the research work focused. And that is why it is very essential that the hypotheses are written in the accurate words using the appropriate variables that are under study. The researcher should take care while writing the hypothesis so that the variables under study are included in the hypothesis. It is only the hypothesis that would be making the research in a specific manner and in a pinpointed way. This paves the way further for the instruments of data collection and the various attributes of it, and so on and so forth.